Good morning. Let's stand and worship together.
Thank you.
Seated for just a moment. Someone shared with me a song some time ago. People all the time sharing, hey, have you heard this song yet? And I do try to work them in as I get to them. So I can't even remember who shared this song with me, but a song called His Mercy Is More. And as I was looking at that song and just looking at God's mercy, looking at some of the verses from God's Word that talk about the promise of His mercy. Psalm 25:6, remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from old. And in Isaiah we see, let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord and he will have mercy on them and to our God, for he will freely pardon. In the Gospel of Luke we read, and his mercy is on those who fear him with godly reverence from generation to generation and age to age. And then in Ephesians, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, saved through his grace and through his mercy.
Praise the Lord, his mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
sing is more. Stronger in the darkness, you live in more. Since they are many, its mercy is more.
Stand and sing this with us.
Thank you.
is in you. Every morning you are faithful. Every moment you are. Every evening you bring mercy, you bring mercy to me.
Amen. Thank God for his mercy. Thank you. You can be seated and our kids will head on back to children's worship.
Look out this morning and I see some folks that I've been praying for this week. I want to thank you for your prayers. This week has been very obvious that God is a God of divine appointments. I was leaving yesterday and encountered a friend. He's seated over to my right this morning. You know, when you meet somebody and you talk to them, we said, Rick, we were going to talk for 10 minutes. We wound up talking for about an hour, yes. And a man of his word, he said, I'll be there in the morning, Pastor. And he's here today. So it's amazing how a parking lot can do the work of God. Yeah. I pray that God will touch your heart today. This is one of those messages where I believe it's a growth message. It's a building message. I want to begin by speaking to you who are parents. Some of you are, some of you aren't, some of you will be. But I think what I've got to say is something that I hope you will store it in the back of your mind and let it saturate your heart and change who you are and how you do things. I would begin by simply saying, parents, it is my opinion based on my experience and also upon my observation that the hardest task you have in raising your children is to teach them to make good choices in life. Good choices, very important. Solomon said, teach your children to choose the right path, and when they are older, they will remain upon it. God gave kids parents to teach them to make right choices, good choices. I believe it's absolutely critical that our children learn to choose wisely because there are before them a million and one choices they're going to have to make in life. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 6, verse 16, don't you realize that whatever you choose to obey becomes your master? You can choose sin, which leads to death, or you can choose to obey God and receive his blessings or his approval. Growing up, my father taught me to choose wisely and not to make the same mistakes that other people make. In other words, learn from other people's mistakes. Don't go through the same struggle that they went through. Try to learn from their mistakes, not your own. You know, and I know, that life is full of choices every day. We have to make choices. We make hundreds of decisions. And that is why it's so critical for us to learn how to make good choices early on in life. Choices can follow you through life, literally with two little feet. Think about that. Choices can follow you into eternity. Your choices can determine and will determine where you spend eternity. There are all kinds of consequences that come from our choices. There are good ones, there are bad ones. There are regrets and there are blessings. Every day you get up and you decide what you're going to wear, and it's good that you consider, is it going to be hot? Is it going to be cold? Is it going to be raining? It helps to know where you're going. It helps to know what you're going to be doing. Those factors factor into what you're going to wear. Every time you stop at a restaurant and go in to eat, you have to make a choice about what you're going to eat. Every restaurant has a selection of entrees to pick from. If you're in the process of looking for someone to marry, you're going to choose who you marry. And hopefully if you choose them, they're going to choose you. And hopefully that's going to be a good choice for both of you. You can choose what profession that you're going to pursue in life. You can choose where you're going to go to college and what your major is going to be. You choose where you want to live and what kind of car or truck you want to drive, and on and on and on and on. There are so many choices. You make so many choices every day of your life. When we're young, our parents make choices for us, but as we get older, we need to learn how to make those choices for ourselves, and parents are wise if they let their kids do that. Life isn't just automatic. You have to choose things, and so you need to learn the art of choosing wisely. Very important. We all have cell phones, and I'm sure that you open up your cell phone from time to time. And if you are checking the weather or if you're checking the news, you're going to see these little ads pop up or these little free apps that will appear. And they want you to click on them and read them and accept them. And every time I see them, I think of, you know, well, I can choose this. I can decline, ignore. I can accept. We all have those kind of choices to make. Every week when we go out to the mailbox will have a certain amount of mail that's good mail, mail that we need. But there's a lot of junk mail in our mailboxes, right? And we kind of sort through that. Well, you know, there are people who kind of sort Jesus out like they sort junk mail out of their list of things that they get in or their stack of mail that they get in the mailbox. Life is full of choices, big choices, little choices. Choices that will only affect you for about this long. And then there are choices that will affect you for all eternity. You've heard me say many, many times that I believe that God allows us to live on this planet for 75 plus years or so for us to decide where we want to spend eternity. This is temporary. You have a choice about making, you have a choice to make about where you're going to spend eternity forever and ever and ever. The Bible tells us that God only gives us two choices, right? Heaven or hell. A cruise on a ship is not one of the choices. You don't get to make that choice. You will spend somewhere in eternity. You don't think about that. But you will. That's a choice you don't get to make. God's made that choice for you. You're going to spend somewhere in eternity. I've said many times, sometimes in funerals, but sometimes from this pulpit, that the grave is the end of no man. A lot of people think when you die, it's over, but it's not. You have eternity to consider. From the very moment that you were conceived in the womb, God destined you to exist somewhere in eternity. You get to choose whether you want to exist with Him or without Him. That's a big choice, but that is a choice you must make. Every time that I teach a new semester of faith, which is our outreach strategy that we use here at Harvest, I have students write out their testimony, their life story, their evangelistic story. It's what your life was like before and after having a life-changing experience with God. And I really enjoy reading those. And they're all different because everybody comes to know Christ from a different direction and a different path. But one thing we share in common, there is only one way to God, and that is through Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible teaches. Years ago, I'll never forget having a conversation with our guide that took care of us when we were in Israel. Joyce and I had an opportunity to go to Israel several years ago, over 20 plus years ago. And it was quite an interesting thing. We went with several of the professors from the Bible college that I attended. And Dr. J.W. Lee was leading that tour. And if my memory serves me right, it was probably his 12th, 13th, or 14th trip. And every year when he would go, he would always use the same Jewish guide. And so they literally became friends. They corresponded through the year. But for some reason, this particular year, that guide was not available to us, and so we had a different guide. We actually had a Lebanese Arab, a man who claimed to be a Christian. He said he was Greek Orthodox. He knew his Bible very well. He knew the nation of Israel. He knew all the places to go to, and he knew how the Bible related to all of those historical sites. And one day we were having a conversation, and I just asked him, hey, can you tell me how long you've been a Christian? And he looked at me, and without hesitation, he said, I've been a Christian all my life. I was born a Christian. Well, that tweaked my interest. You see, he believed that he literally was born a Christian, that by being birthed, he became a Christian. And that was because his parents claimed to be a Christian. And so he assumed that he automatically became a Christian because he was born into that family. So in his thinking, salvation for him was somehow genetically transferred to him from his parents. Since that day and that conversation, I've had quite a few conversations with people who have made similar claims, albeit from some different and for some different reasons. Some people think that being good makes you a Christian, and so because maybe there's nothing major that's ever been messed up in your life, you've not made any huge bad decisions, they can assume that that makes you a Christian. They're good people, so they think that's a Christian virtue. Some people believe that because God is such a loving God that he is going to take everybody into heaven, that he's not going to leave anybody out, that everybody becomes a Christian at some point. There are even people who have been raised inside the church that wrongly assume that religious association automatically makes them a Christian. It's kind of like they believe that Christianity can rub off on you if you get close enough to those who are true believers. My wife, Joyce, followed a friend down the aisle in a revival service when she was 14 years old. Her friend was truly saved and joined the church. But all that happened to Joyce was she became a church member. Well, how did that happen? Well, nobody took the time to talk to Joyce about how to come to faith in Christ. Nobody dealt properly with her about the conviction of her sin in her life. And all they really had her do was fill out a membership card. And later on, she was baptized. So get this, she was a member of the church. She was baptized in that church, but none of that did anything to save her soul. I married Joyce thinking she was a believer. And it wasn't until later, after we'd been married for many years, that she came to faith in Christ. Now, I confess to you, I married a lost church member, but she was a better person than I was. Still is. Still much better than I am. I think it's very important that we all realize that there is a time in our lives when we're all lost and separated from God. We don't think about that. And if you are a true believer right now, then there was a specific time and a place where you accepted Christ and God saved your lost soul. I'm meddling, aren't I? Christian, you were once lost and separated from God. And then you were saved by faith in Jesus Christ. If you're not a Christian, God hasn't transformed your life, your soul, then you're still lost and separated from God. You're either on one side of that spiritual fence or you're on the other side of that spiritual fence. You're either a part of the kingdom of God or you're a part of the kingdom of Satan. That's what the Bible says. You are one or the other. You cannot straddle that spiritual fence. When Paul was writing to the Christians in Colossae, he wrote these words. He said, you were once so far away from God, far away, separated from God. He said, you were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. We don't like to think of ourselves that way. We like to think, hey, well, I'm not that bad. I'm okay. But look at what he wrote in 1 Corinthians 6. Keep in mind, he's writing to the church, but you know and I know that not everybody in the church is saved, right? Hello? He's writing to a mixed crowd here. But he says, he's speaking to the believers, he said, don't you know that those who do wrong, those who sin, will have no share in the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourself. Those who indulge in sexual sin who are idol worshipers, adulterers, male prostitutes, and you would have to include female prostitutes here, homosexuals, thieves, greedy people, drunkards, abusers, swindlers, none of these, he says, will have a share in the kingdom of God. Why? Because they're not a part of it. But notice what he says in verse 11, and it's important that you understand the context of this. Again, he's speaking to a mixed crowd. He's speaking to some people who are still in that lost state, while he's also speaking to some who have changed their address, their spiritual address. Verse 11, he says, there was a time. Notice, that's his word, not mine. There was a time when some of you were just like that, but now your sins have been washed away and you have been set apart for God. You have been made right. You used to be wrong, but now you've been made right with God because of what the Lord Jesus Christ and the Spirit of our God have done for you. So, if I read that right, there is a time in everybody's life when we're not right with God. I tell kids, you start out with God like this. This is God, this is you. You start out like this, but when you start sinning, it takes you further and further away from God. And it only takes one to bridge, two, to make a gap between you and God. One sin, that's all it takes. So there's a time of spiritual lostness in every one of our lives. There's a time of spiritual death. Paul talks to the Romans about that in Romans chapter 3, verse 21. He says God has a way to make people, what? Right with him. Without the law. In other words, you don't get saved by keeping the Ten Commandments. Although we should live by them. There's nothing wrong with that, but they're not going to save you. For one reason, you can't keep them, right? Yeah. The Bible says if you break one, you're guilty as if you broke them all. God has a way to make people right with him without the law, and he has now shown us that way which the law and the prophets told us about. Verse 22, God makes people right with himself through their faith in Jesus Christ. This is true for all who believe in Christ because all people are the same. Did you hear that? All people are the same. We do the same thing. We are guilty of the same thing. Verse 23 bears that out. He said, all have sinned and are not good enough for God's glory. We all sin, for all sin and fall short of the glory of God. In verse 24 he says, and all need to be made right with God by his grace, which is a free gift. It's not earned, it's a gift. He said they, and we could include us, we need to be made right from sin. We need to be made free from sin through Jesus Christ. So how is a person made right with God? The simple short answer is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. The long answer is by putting our faith in Jesus Christ, God makes us right with himself. When we trust him as our Lord and Savior, then we are saved and forgiven and given a place in the family of God. Colossians 2:6 says, you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord. You didn't just accept him to be your Savior. You gave your life to him. You became his possession. You made him Lord of your life. Friends, that's all you can do. That's all you can do. That's all you have to do. The Bible says you must turn to God by accepting Christ as Lord and Savior. Not just Savior, but Lord and Savior. It says that you must turn loose of Satan by abandoning your sinful life. That's what repentance is. It is turning away from your life of sinfulness. It's turning away from sin itself and turning to God. And we all need Jesus living in us to be able to help us do that. John chapter 1 verse 10 said, but although the world was made through him, through Jesus, through Christ, the world didn't recognize him when he came. Even his own land and among his own people, he was not accepted. But to all who believed in him and accepted him, he gave the right to become. Notice that. They weren't, but he says they became children of God by accepting and believing in Christ. He said in verse 13, they are reborn. This is not a physical birth resulting from human passion or a plan. This rebirth comes from God. We need to kind of get a visual and understand that Jesus literally left heaven, came down to earth, lived among us for 33 sinless years. Some of us can't put together 33 sinless minutes. But he lived 33 sinless years. But you know what? The very people that he created didn't recognize him when he came. His own people refused to accept him. It's sad what sin does to us, but sin is so powerful and so addicting that it blinds the eyes of people so that they don't recognize their own creator. Even his own people, the Jews, who knew from the promises of God that he was coming and they'd been waiting for him for hundreds of years. Those who should have recognized him, they rejected him and they refused to accept Jesus as their Messiah. Oh, but he was. He was God's gift to man. Verse 12 said, but to all who believed in him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. You know, to accept Jesus is more than just going out to your mailbox and mindlessly removing your mail, though again, some sort Jesus out like he were junk mail. To accept Jesus as Lord and Savior is to welcome him into your life, just like you would warmly welcome a friend to come and stay in your house for an indefinite period of time. Anyone who accepts Jesus, according to the Word of God, is adopted into the family of God. We become his children. He said he gave us the right to become children of God. To believe in the name of Jesus is to believe in his person, who he is. It's also to believe in his work, what he has done. Listen, friends, when you accept and trust Jesus Christ for the forgiveness that you need and you accept that free gift of eternal life, you undergo a supernatural birth. A supernatural birth. That's how and when you enter the family of God. That is when you're made right with God. Remember, there's a time. That is when you leave Satan's family and you join God's family. That's when the Holy Spirit comes to live inside of you for all eternity. That's when he seals your soul under the day of redemption. And that all happens when you are born again. Look again at verse 13 with me. He writes, they are reborn. This is not a physical birth resulting from human passion. Two people being in love with each other, a man and a woman, who are able to produce a child. This is not from any plan they would make. This rebirth, he says, comes from God. All children, all Christians, children of God, are born twice. Obviously, you're born once physically. But you're also born once spiritually. And let me just stress that. You're only born once spiritually. You don't have to be born over and over again. You have to be born once, but not multiple times. Just as all babies are meant to be born one time, so all Christians are born and saved only once. But you must be born this second spiritual birth for you to have a relationship with God and get into heaven. Just joining the church, becoming a Baptist or a Methodist or a Catholic or a Presbyterian, that's not going to get you into heaven. And you know, from time to time, people will come to me and they'll say, Pastor, I need to be baptized. I want you to baptize me. Well, if you're not saved when I baptize you, you're still not saved when you get out. You're just wet. And I can dunk you every day for the rest of your life, and unless you have Jesus in your heart, you're just going to get wetter. Jesus clearly tells us that to be saved, you have to accept him by a personal choice, by trusting him to make things right between you and God, and by being spiritually birthed into the kingdom of God. Last week, we briefly looked at this story of Nicodemus. I told Miss Cece the other day, this is my favorite character in all the Bible, Nicodemus. I love to study his life. I wish there was more information about him. I can't wait to meet him in heaven. He came to Jesus with a burning question that was on his heart. You know, when you're young, you don't think about dying. Right? You think you're invincible. But death is not a respecter of anybody's person. You can die young just as you can die old. Nicodemus was an old man, so he was beginning to think, well, you know, I don't have a whole lot of time left. I got to make sure I get this right. And so he comes to Jesus. He wants to know what he has to do to get into heaven. We know that because of the answer that Jesus gives him. Look at verse 3. Jesus said, I assure you, Nicodemus, unless you're born again, you can never see the kingdom of God. In other words, you're not even going to get close enough to see it. But then Nicodemus, being the human that he was, he said, what in the world do you mean? How can an old man like me go back into my mother's womb and be born again? I can assure you, if my mom was still alive, she would refuse that. She had enough trouble birthing me the first time. In verse 5, Jesus says to him, and this is big. He says, the truth is. Truth matters, right? We talked about that the other day. Truth matters. Truth is real. There is absolute truth, and this is one of them. The truth is, Jesus said, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives new life from heaven. So don't be surprised at my statement, Jesus said, that you must be born again. That comes from the authority of Jesus Christ, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. My friends, the world that you and I live in today wants you to believe its lies about who and what Jesus is. They want you to believe that Jesus is nothing more than just a good Jewish prophet. They want you to believe that he was a great teacher who lived in the past, but he's dead and he's gone. They want you to believe that he's never coming back as he promised that he would. They want you to believe that Jesus isn't God's only way into heaven, that there are other ways. They want you to believe that Jesus is irrelevant for today and that you don't need him into your life. And most of all, they want you to believe that Jesus was never God. Never was, never will be. But my friends, Jesus is God. And I say that based on the authority of Scripture. And I say to you, you need him in your life. I want you to look back at what Paul wrote again in Colossians 2:6, he says, and now, just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord, you must continue to follow him. That's a directive. Think about it. If you need Jesus to give you life with God in heaven, then doesn't it make sense that you're going to need Jesus to help you live your life here on earth? You know my answer for that? Absolutely. Absolutely. So after you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, then what's next? I've watched it now for a lot of years, and I firmly believe a lot of people do this. I believe there are people who think that if they will pray a prayer, walk an aisle, get a little wet, join a church, that they get their ticket punched, and that's all there is. Hello? I'm here to tell you, that's just the beginning. But it's got to be real. It's got to be from the heart, not something you just do for the sake of doing it. What's next? I will say to you that your Christian life is supposed to continue just the way that it began. And that is by faith in Jesus Christ and his word. When Paul wrote this section of his letter to the believers in Colossae, he was very much concerned about the false teachers of the world and how they would continue to lie to the people of God and lead them away from the gospel truth. Colossians 2:4 and 5 says, I'm telling you this, Paul said, so that no one will be able to deceive you with persuasive arguments. For though I am far away from you, my heart is with you, and I am very happy because you are living as you should and because of your strong faith in Christ. We need to be able to discern spiritual truth today from worldly lies, right? So how do you do that? Well, you have to look at the standard of truth. Well, what is the standard of truth? That's the Word of God. That's the Bible. It is our supreme spiritual standard for discerning spiritual truth from what is nothing more than worldly lies. I want to refer to the Baptist Faith and Message. If you've ever gone through my pastor's class, you've received a little copy of the Baptist Faith and Message, and it speaks about 18 different essential beliefs that we have about God, about Scripture, about who we are, where we're going, how we're saved. You know, there's a lot in there. This is what it says in the Baptist Faith and Message about Scripture. It says, the Holy Bible was written by men, divinely inspired, and is God's revelation of Himself to man. It is a perfect treasure of divine instruction. It has God for its author, salvation for its end, and truth without any mixture of error for its matter. Therefore, all Scripture is totally true and trustworthy. It reveals the principles by which God judges us and therefore is and will remain to the end of the world the true center of Christian union and the supreme standard by which all human conduct, creeds, and religious opinion should be tried. All Scripture is a testimony to Christ, who is Himself the focus of divine revelation. Amen and amen. Now, I'm pretty confident that you and I believe that. That's one of the things that we stress here. We stress believing good, sound, biblical doctrine that come from the Word of God. The world would never believe this. It doesn't believe this. It never has. It never will. And for me, what troubles me is that I'm seeing more and more the attempt to disregard truth and slide the lies of Satan into the mainstream of what the church is now teaching. Listen, I read just like you do that there is growing disunity among denominations across our world. You want to know why? It all has to do with truth. Some will accept truth, some will reject truth, and they are swapping truth for lies. In the early church, just as it is in our own day, it is so critically important that we have a firm understanding of the deity of Christ. We need to know who Jesus is. You cannot, I believe, be a true Christian without accepting and understanding the true knowledge of Jesus Christ and who He is. What does the Bible say about Jesus? That He is God incarnate. God who came to live and dwell among us in the flesh. He is God. John MacArthur writes this about this particular subject. He says, so many Christians who affirm the deity of Christ live as if He were not the one in whom all spiritual sufficiency resides. But Jesus is the one in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. He alone is sufficient. Do you believe that? Do you believe Jesus is really all you need in life and in eternity? He says the basic attack of all false systems throughout history has been to deny either Christ's deity or His sufficiency to save and to sanctify, or both. Well, hello. That's right where we are today. Friends, we haven't seen anything yet. More lies are coming. Your faith and God's church are in the crosshairs of Satan's world system. So buckle up and put on the whole armor of God and stand strong, stand firm, stand together. We are living in a day when you'd better know what you believe and you better know why you believe it. The Apostle Paul understood that, and because of what he saw that was coming in his day, and even in our day, he exhorted all of us who, having accepted Christ, he wants us to follow the Lord in several ways. Now, Paul clearly wants us to think about what's next after salvation. Look at what he says in Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. So as you received Christ Jesus, in other words, as you were saved by putting faith in Christ, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, he says, walk in him, rooted in him, built upon him, and established in the faith as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. I want you to focus with me on some things that Paul encourages us to do. He wants us, first of all, to learn how to walk in Christ Jesus. I remember my dad was a small guy. He was only about 5'6" and a half, wore a 6 1/2 shoe as an adult. And so as a small boy, I could run along with dad and step in his footprints in the sand. And I was learning how to walk with my dad. And that's what Paul's kind of talking about here. As you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, walk in him. Walk in him. I'm pretty sure, because you're human, that you have habits. Anybody here not have habits? That's what I thought. We all have habits, right? Some are good, some are bad, right? Habits are those things that you do over and over again. In the New Testament here, the word walk describes things that we do habitually, things that we do almost instinctively. And Paul is instructing us as believers to walk in Christ as a way of life. The word walk here is a combination of two Greek words that literally mean to walk around. To walk around. He's not telling us to walk around in circles. Instead, this word that describes is meant to describe our walk of life, our lifestyle. It's things that we're to do for the glory of God. Over and over again. To walk in Christ is to live your life patterned after His. To walk in the Lord's steps. To live as He lived. Our spiritual lives grow through the discipline of our godly habits and our repeated actions. But it doesn't mean just because we're walking in the Lord that we're to live a dull life. Being Christian is not dull. Walk is a verb used in the present tense that suggests that a spirit-filled believer walks around with God every day. How many times have you walked with the Lord this week? Have you gone where He goes? Have you thought like He thinks? Have you done what He does? We all need to spend more time walking with God. Amen? I think so. He also talks about the need to be rooted and built up in Christ. So as you receive Christ Jesus the Lord, walk in Him, rooted in Him, and built up in Him. I love to garden, and this is one of those times of year when I really enjoy doing that, although it wears me out more than it used to. I'm not quite as young as I used to be, but I think I'm a pretty decent gardener. But I've learned a lot from a lot of people. A lot of people taught me about gardening, and I don't know who actually told me this, but somebody taught me years ago how to plant tomatoes. And it's important how you plant tomatoes. If you just plant that plant right on top of the ground, it's not going to do very well. But they taught me to take your tomato plant and plant 2/3 of your tomato plant under the ground. In other words, if you have a 15-inch plant, put 10 inches of it in the ground. Even some of the lower petals and leaves, you put them under the soil and cover them over. Why? They'll root. You only leave just a little bit out of it. That's all you need, just a little bit. What you need is the roots to go down into the ground so they can reach the nutrients and water. That's how you make for a much healthier root system, which then will produce a lot of really good fruit. John MacArthur makes a spiritual application here, and here's what he says. He says, spiritual maturity develops upward from the foundation of biblical truth. In other words, a healthy root system grows out of sound doctrine, which must be built on biblical truth. Well, how in the world do we know if we have a poor spiritual root system or not. I would just tell you to observe your life. You know whether your root system is good or bad or strong or poor, because sometimes things like worry and fear and anxiety and stress and guilt and shame and resentment and bitterness and all kind of things like that just keep popping up in your life. Everywhere you turn, one of them pops up, kind of like weeds. All of these issues are the result of not having a good, strong spiritual root system in the Lord. And that's exactly why Paul says that he wants us to be well-rooted in God. He wants us to be rooted in the Word of God, rooted in the love of God, rooted in and faith and hope that comes from the Lord. Why do we need to do that? I'll tell you why. Because storms have a tendency to blow into our lives, right? I can't keep storms out of your life. I can't do that. I can't even keep them out of my life. You can't avoid storms, and you can't outrun storms. That's exactly why you need a strong spiritual root system, so that storms don't blow you away. Well, Brother Randy, how do I develop a strong spiritual root system? It's going to sound too simple for you, but I'm going to tell you anyway. There's only two things that you need to do. First of all, you need to spend more time with God. Spend more time with God. Spend more time praying to God. Spend more time in His Word. Be honest with yourself. Don't tell me, don't tell your neighbor, but how many times have you prayed this week? How many times have you opened up the Word of God and read truth from Scripture? You want strong roots? You got to pray, and you got to study the Word of God. You also need to spend more time with God's people. Be with Christians, fellowship with them, serve with them. Let them be a part of your life. Paul says this, "And I pray that Christ will be more and more at home in your lives as you trust in Him. May your roots grow down deep into the soil of God's marvelous love." Something else Paul says. He said, "You must also firmly establish your faith in Christ." He said, "So as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, walk in Him, rooted in Him, and built up upon Him, and established in the faith as you were taught." The passive voice of the Greek participle here that Paul chose to use for the word established indicates that it is God alone who establishes you and I as believers. It's a word that means to make. It's a word that means to confirm or to validate or to make permanent. Friends, God first established you when He saved your lost soul. He established you as a child of God. He made that a permanent transaction. But He also establishes us every day as He shapes our life, growing our faith as He walks through those storms with us, the ups and downs of life. And Paul says in Ephesians 4:13, he said, "This will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ." So, I hate to tell you this, but those struggles that you're going through, they're going to come and go, but there are going to be others. Why? Because God's shaping your life. But He doesn't want you to go through those storms alone. He wants you to walk through those storms side by side with Him, letting Him guide you through them. So the next thing that we all need to do after we put our faith in Christ is to learn to walk with Him. Learn to walk in His shoes. We need to learn to develop our spiritual roots with a healthy diet from God's Word. And we need to allow God to firmly establish our faith and our trust in Him. But He says there's one more thing that we need to do. One more thing. He said we all have to have and need to have a grateful heart for all that God has done for us. How grateful are you? He said we need to be abounding in thanksgiving. We need to praise God for all the things He's done in our past. I confess, so much of my life is lived not thinking about the blessings that God has given me. We need to count our blessings, and we need to thank God. We need to tell the story of what God has blessed us with and how He's blessed our lives. And I enjoyed talking to Rick yesterday, and we were looking at the property, and I began to tell our story here at Harvest, how blessed we've been. Guys, there are so many blessings that we receive being a part of the family of God right here at Harvest. And we need to tell that story. We need to praise God for His gifts. How many people today are meeting in a movie theater or an elementary school? Where are we at? We've got a home. We need to be thankful. This is a gift from God, and we need to give Him praise for it. Look with me at Hebrews 13:15. Last verse I'm going to give you this morning. The writer of Hebrews said, with Jesus' help, let us continually offer our sacrifice of praise to God by proclaiming the glory of His name. We need to praise God. I enjoyed singing this morning. The worship music that Ronnie put together this week was very encouraging to worship our Father and our Lord and our Savior. I just want you to think about, as I go into this moment of invitation, if we're saved, what's next? If you're not saved, what's next? I said yesterday, what God teaches us today, somehow He wants to use that tomorrow. So let's apply that. What you've heard this morning, somehow God wants to use that to change who we were into who He wants us to be. What's next for you with God? What's God want to do in your life that you've been maybe holding back? Maybe some of you need to accept Christ today. Maybe you need to trust Him as your Lord and Savior. You need to make that big adjustment in your life. Let Him transform you from the kingdom of Satan into the kingdom of God. Maybe you just need to recommit your life and be more focused on walking with the Lord. Be more committed, more established in your faith, more grounded and built up in Him. I don't know, but I know this. God doesn't want you to leave here the way you came. He wants you to be different. He wants you to be changed. And He'll do that for you if you'll let Him. But you have to make that decision to trust Him. I can't do that for you. That's why you need to learn to make good choices. Trusting God. Let's pray. Father, thank You for Your word, for Your truth. Thank You for letting it penetrate our heart this morning. I pray, God, that it's done that. I pray that it hasn't just fallen on deaf ears. And God, I pray that we don't leave here the same way we came, because in all sincerity, we change one way or the other. We either draw closer to You or we move further away. I want You to do the work, God, that You desire to do in my heart, but I also pray for You to do that in other hearts. Help people to come to know You stronger and deeper in their faith than they ever have before. May Your will be done in all of our lives so that You receive the glory. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you stand with me? Will you do what God's put on your heart to do? Be obedient in what's next that He has for you to do with your life. Trust Him, trust Him, trust Him. Please do that.
Open up the skies of mercy. Rain down the cleansing flood, healing waters rise around us. Hear our cries, Lord, let them rise. It's Your kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire. It's Your beauty, Lord, that makes us stand in silence. Your love is better than life. can feel your mercy falling. You are turning our hearts back again. Hear our praises rise to heaven. Draw us near, Lord, lead us here.
Alrighty, a lot of stuff going on, even more stuff going on coming up in the near future. Where do I play this thing? Oh, here it is right here. Okay. We will be having Bible study in just a few moments, so we invite you to stick around for that. Hope you can find a class. If you need one, there's one that meets right over here.
Come to the well that never runs.